Welcome to Module 3 of Point Set Topology course. Last time we had taken a cursory look on what are called as normed linear spaces. They were seen to be an immediate generalization of the modulus function on the field of real numbers or complex numbers. Okay, so today we are going to take one more step towards a generalization. Once again, we go back to this modulus function on K. This K denotes, remember, is set of all real numbers or set of all complex numbers, any one of them. So take the distance function dxy, where x and y are elements of K, to be modulus of x minus 1. Okay. Inside the real numbers or inside R cross R with complex numbers, this actually coincides with the standard notion of distance. So it is called, you can call it a distance function. What are the fundamental properties of distance function? Just like yesterday, what we observed about the modulus function itself, now those three properties will be picked up today also. What are they? The first thing is the distance function is always a non-negative real number, and it is zero if and only if x is equal to y. The second thing is the distance function is symmetric. Dxy is the same thing as dyx. Distance, that's why it's called distance between x and y. Distance from x to y is the same thing as distance from y to x. So that is the meiosis. The third one is more clearly this time is triangle inequality. Distance between xy is less than or equal to distance between x and z plus distance between z and y. So if x, y, z are three points, okay, forming a triangle, so this just says that the length of any side, say x to y, is less than or equal to sum of the lengths of the other two sides, namely x to z and z to y. So this is much direct as compared to the norm of x plus y was less than or equal to norm of x plus norm of y. To interpret that one as a triangle inequality, you have to use the vector method. Represent x, represent y as vectors, lines from 0 to 1, point x. So take the arrow from 0 to x, 0 to y, and then take the sum, that will be another third point. So now the end points become a triangle. That is the meaning of the norm of x plus y is less than or equal to norm of x plus norm of y. Okay. So we take exactly those three, but formulated now in terms of d. Look at dxy equal to 0. What does it mean? Modulus of x minus y equal to 0. Okay, which was norm. So modulus of x minus y is equal to 0. X minus y is 0. That means x is equal to y. So this is identical with the condition 1, which we had called norm 1. The beauty of this one is now the condition is independent of the additivity on the vector space. Okay, so that is what has happened. Similarly, the third condition is independent of the additivity. You don't have to take norm of x plus y. There is no x plus y. Distance to x and y is less than distance x. That plus, this plus is, by the way, On the right hand side, this is just real numbers addition. Okay, so the left hand sides here or the starting things here, the conditions, they are independent of the vector space structure on V, and that allows us to make a sweeping generalization. That's what we are going to do. So I'm repeating it here once again, if you have missed it. The condition 1 and 3 here are parallel to N1 and N3. This N1 and N3 were the norm for the norm conditions, same conditions. This was whatever you call positive definiteness. This was a triangle inequality. But this N2 seems to be just an idea. No, something weaker, right? Whereas the N2 there was something about alpha times x, if you take the norm of that, modulus of alpha came out. Okay, norm of alpha x was equal to modulus of alpha into norm of x. So that was quite a strong condition, but this is just, this doesn't seem to be place here at all. So it may be true, but why this is so fundamental? So that is something which you have to think about. Okay, but how to derive this one? That is not all that difficult. Okay, we will check that into what. So right now, let us make this sweeping generalization, namely, start with any set X now. Remember, for a norm linear space, we have to start with a vector space V. So there is no extra structure, it's just a set here, X. Now, if take a function D from X cross X to 0, 1, the norm was directly a function on the vector space. The distance is between two points. That's why you have to take X cross X to 0, infinity. A function like this is called a metric. That is the name we are going to give, okay? So you could have called it just distance metric. So classically it has been called as metric, so we are going to call it as metric. Otherwise, it would be distance function also. So what is the condition? There are three conditions which you can call it as axioms of metric space. Positive definiteness, which corresponds to dxy equal to 0, if and only if x equal to y. Symmetry, dxy equal to dyx. Triangle inequalities, dxy is less than or equal to dx z plus dyz for every x and y and z. So take these three conditions here, which are true for modulus function on K, generalize it to those exactly three functions. It's what we have. Such a thing will be called a distance function or a metric. Okay, so what we have is, take any set X and a metric on it. The ordered pair X comma D is going to be called as metric space. Okay, but quite often we'll just say X is a metric space without mentioning what is our D. Quite often the distance function, the metric, is understood by the context. Okay. Or it is mentioned just a few minutes back, so you don't have to again and again mention it. That is the only reason why you have to do that one, just to save some time. Otherwise, logically, every time you have to say X, comma, D is a metric or metric space, then only it makes sense. Okay. Is that clear? Now, one sweeping generalization definition is over, that's all. So slowly you have to build up the theory. Okay? Just like what we have done for subspace of a normed linear space. What is it? It is a vector subspace, and then the norm is restricted to the subspace. Similarly, take any metric space, okay, x comma d, take a subset x prime, restrict the metric d to x prime cross x prime, then you will get a metric subspace. So then what you can say, x prime comma d prime is a metric subspace of xd. Okay, so this is the definition. X prime is subspace, subset of x. D prime is a restriction of d on the x cross x prime cross x prime, which is subset of x cross x. D is defined on x cross x, take the restriction. All those properties will be automatically true for x prime, d prime. Okay. So we can just say, instead of my mentioning d prime, etc., we can quite often write it as same d also. Quite often restricted function, we use the same notation. Okay, just to save time and, you know, instead of cumbersome too many notations, that's all. We can just say x prime is a submetric space of x. Okay, so that is the just the second definition. After making a metric space, we have made a metric subspace. So slowly we have to develop a number of terminologies and theories. So all based on similar experience with modulus function, what it is doing for real numbers or complex numbers. So remember that. Okay. So here are a few more terminology. So start with a metric space. Take any point in the space. Take any real number between 0 and infinity, any positive real number. Now, by an open ball of radius r and center x at x, this is the definition now. Okay, what is the meaning of open ball? An open ball always has a center and a radius. The radius must be some positive number. Unless you mention it, it is not clear what it is. The open ball is an open ball. Okay, what is it? It is set of all points y inside x which are at a distance less than r from x. Dyx is less than r. That is an open ball. Just put equality that dyx less than or equal to r, allow equality also here, then you get a closed ball. So we will use br for open ball and drxt for closed ball. This x denotes the center, r denotes the radius, and d denotes the metric. In the same space x, same set x, if you change the d to some other metric, these balls will be different, obviously. Okay, so that's why you have put that d also there. But if you understand what this d is, just like I can call x a metric space, here also I don't need to mention d, then I will have a shorter notation, namely br of x is br of xd. That d is not mentioned. Okay, that d is understood. Similarly, dr of x is dr of xd. Okay. So this provided you know what metric you are speaking with respect to. All right, so now you know a few more definitions. So let me again go back to emphasize that our standard example with which we begin is just the field K itself together with dxy equal to x minus y. This is the starting example after all. So this first example, this is called the usual metric on R or C, whatever, coming out of the modulus function. Okay, it's also called Euclidean metric because it is so ancient, goes back all the way to Euclid. Okay, more than 2000 years old. Okay, so in that sense, if you take whatever we have defined, namely take a metric on C, restrict it to R, then you get a metric subspace. But this function is the same. okay, when you take x and y as real number, when you take the modulus of x minus y, it's the same thing as when you take them as complex numbers. Okay, so this is the first example of a metric space and a submetric space. R is a submetric space of C, okay, with the usual metric. So the second example here is take any nonlinear space that we have studied last time, a vector space together with a norm. Then you define D of UE just like we defined modulus of x minus y. You define norm of U minus V. D of UE is norm of U minus V. Then D1 is first one follows directly from N1. Right? What is D1? Dx, DUV is 0 if and only if U equal to V. DUV is 0 means norm of U minus V is 0. Then U minus V is 0, that means U is equal to V. So that is N1. Similarly, N3, which is triangle inequality stated in terms of vectors, is equivalent to triangle inequality stated in terms of the distance function D3. So they are fine. But what we wonder about is number 2. How do you get UV equal to U minus V? That is very easy here. D of VU is by definition. I want to show that it is equal to D of UV, right? D of VU is norm of V minus U. So it, this has a symmetry. That's a point. It is minus 1 times norm of U minus V. V minus U can be written like this. But this now minus 1 comes out with a modulus. And that is now just 1. So that is equal to U of U. So the symmetry property of the norm function, which is much weaker than, okay, modulus of alpha times something coming out, alpha coming out and so on, that is just forgotten. We don't need that one. But we have retained something else, namely the symmetry. Okay? So that is the beauty. So this is definitely going to be something more general. Okay? If I just write D of alpha U and alpha V here, there is no way this alpha will come out. Mod alpha will not come out in general. It is not a part of the axiom. Whereas, if your metric is defined using a norm, then that is true. Okay, so that's what I want to repeat it here. First of all, whenever we have a metric coming out of a norm, then we call it a metric associated with the norm. In short, we can call it as linear metric. The linearity is coming from modulus of, you know, norm of alpha times x is equal to modulus of alpha times norm of x. And of course, triangle inequality. Triangle inequality is always there. So number 2 makes it a linear metric here. Okay. But in general, this is not a part of the definition of the metric. You have to be careful about that. Okay. And whenever such a D happens, we may indicate it by writing D suffix norm, whatever norm you have taken. Suppose there are two different norms on the same vector space V. They will give rise to two different metrics. So which one? So you better tell that. So in that case, suppose norms are written as norm 1 and norm 2, two different norms. Then I guess correspondingly D1 and D2 are the matrix. So this is the way we will treat how these metrics are related to the corresponding norm. Okay. If D is a linear metric, it has two additional properties. So I repeat it, I already told you. One is this D of Rx, Ry is mod R times dxy. Xy belong to V, R belong to K. Okay. The second property, which is also hidden there, is distance between x plus z, y plus z. This x plus z, y plus z makes sense because I am working inside a vector space V now. This is same thing as what? It is same thing as what? Norm of x plus y minus y plus z, which is z and z cancels away. It's equal to norm of x minus y, which is equal to d of xy. So this property is additivity. You can directly state, okay, on a vector space, if you start with a metric, suppose you can put this as a condition. So one can have this as condition. It is satisfied with the linear metric. But in addition, I can put this as a condition for an arbitrary metric on a vector space. Then it will be called translation invariant metric. A linear metric is automatically translation invariant. Okay, this condition itself is called translation invariance of D. Similarly, there is multiplication invariance, you can say. This is scalar multiplicative. Namely, R doesn't count out directly, R comes out as modulus of. Okay. So something is not a linear metric if even this condition or this condition is not satisfied. That's easy way of checking whether a given metric comes from a norm or not. Okay. If it is, then this will satisfy it, but that doesn't guarantee that it is coming from. Then there is a likelihood that it may be coming from. Okay. On the other hand, if any of these condition is not satisfied, then you are happy. Oh, okay, this is not norm. Okay. So let us have something now which are actually not coming from norm at all, or maybe coming from norm, but we have not bothered. We can directly define them. Okay. So there are lots and lots of such metrics which arise without reference to any norm. Let us see a few of them. Okay, start with any set. Define this delta as delta of xy equal to 0 if x is equal to y and equal to 1 otherwise. As soon as x and y are not different, it is 1. This delta is actually the opposite of the delta function, Dirac delta function in analysis, okay? So that is the contrast here. It's straightforward to check that this is a metric. What you have to check? D of xy is 0 implies x is equal to y. That's built in the definition here. Okay, dxy equal to dyx, that is all built in the definition. Triangle inequality takes 2 more seconds. You just think about it. Why dissatisfies triangle inequality? It doesn't take more than 2 seconds, that's all you have to think about. Okay, so this is a metric. And it has a name, it is called discrete metric, not Dirac metric, okay? Yeah. So this is a discrete metric. Next, I will give you something which is quite non-trivial, out of the blue. I will not explain how it came today, but I will just give you, today you have to only understand the computational aspect here. Part of it I will do, part of it I will leave it as an exercise. So what is this? The called metric. It is defined on the set of complex numbers. It is not going to be coming from any norm, okay? At least not on C as a vector space. So this DC, C for chord, TC from C cross C to 0 infinity is defined as DC of Z1, Z2 is twice the modulus of Z1 minus Z2, which is quite near, you know, you are looking at normal activity. It is multiplied by 2, that's okay. But this part, the numerator is quite close to nor now. It's twice the norm of modulus of z1 minus z2. But there is a denominator here which will kill all these properties. Okay, what is it? 1 plus mod z1 square into 1 plus mod z2 square, whole thing raised to half. The square root of the product of these two, 1 plus mod z1 square and 1 plus mod z2 square. Okay, so that is the denominator. So this is the definition. See, I have divided, but this is never zero, so I can divide. So this makes sense. So this is now a real number. Okay, and positive non-negative real number. If this is zero, the numerator must be zero. That means z1 is equal to z2, mod z1 equal to mod z2, z1 minus z2 is zero, so z1 is actually equal to z2. Okay, so this is, this satisfies condition d1. Look at dz2, z1 is perfectly symmetric here because modulus of z1 minus z2 is modulus of z2 minus z1. And these things are, you can change this term to here, that's all. So this is symmetric. So what is difficult here? The difficulty is, this is not very easy either. It is not very difficult, but it is not quite easy either. Is a triangle inequality. By the way, in all these cases, triangle inequality verification is the most difficult part. Okay, other things, if they are there, they come easily. If they are not there, you can't help it. They are not there, over. Okay, so let me help you to see how the triangle inequality comes here. I will not do the entire computation. The first thing is, there is some inequality of complex numbers. Take z1 and z2 are complex numbers. Okay, 1 plus mod z1, z1 plus z1, z2 modulus square is less than or equal to 1 plus mod z1 square, 1 plus mod z2 square. Where are these coming from? Look at here. So it's a square of that. If you take the square root, so modulus of 1 plus z1, z2 is less than or equal to this one. So this is the first inequality that you have to see. So this denominator here is bigger than 1 plus mod z1 z2 square. Or square is not there now. If you deny half of, you have taken already. So 1 plus mod z1 z2. That is what you have to see. This itself is not difficult. You have to just expand this one. 1 plus mod z1 z2 square is nothing but 1 plus mod z1 z2 into 1 plus mod z1 z2 bar, which is same thing as 1 plus z1 bar z2 bar. Now expand it, collect it, one of the terms, the central term, namely twice real part of z1 z2, you can replace it by what? Mod z1 square mod z2 plus mod z2 square, and then you will get this. Okay, so that is the explanation for this one. There is another, though looking somewhat threatening here, but this is much simpler. This is an identity. See, this is the product of two terms here. It's a product of two terms plus product of two terms. So there are 2 plus 4 8 terms here. There are 4 terms here. But you can immediately see that 4 of the terms cancel out 2 by 2. Minus z3 here, plus z3 here. Minus z3, z2, z3 bar. Minus z2, minus, plus z3, z2, z2 bar. So something you will cancel out. What you will get is same term here. So this is an equality. Okay. Once you do this one, combine with this one, the triangle inequality will come very easily. Okay. So that part I will leave to you. So I leave the further calculations to you as an exercise. All right. Now we go one step ahead here. Look at what is called as extended complex plane. The extended complex plane In this, you take the complex numbers along with infinity, one single infinity. Okay, don't do much of algebra there, but you can do a lot of topology and analysis. That is why it is there. It's extended complex plane. So one extra point set theoretically, that's all. But now I want to extend the metric, the chord metric, to this set C hat. What you have to do? Whenever the whole, both of them are in C, this is the formula. So if one of them is infinity, I have to define what is the meaning of this. Namely, I have to define, take any Z, in the second chord, in the second term here, infinity. What is DC of Z infinity? This is what I have to do. So what I do, take Z1, Z2 here, and let Z2 go to infinity. In this RH says, take Z2 going to infinity, take the limit. Okay. What you get is this formula. Of course, instead of Z1, I am writing Z here, that's all. So 2 divided by 1 plus mod Z square raised to half. To work it out, it's not very difficult. How do you take the limit as Z to infinity? This is infinity by infinity method. Oh, don't worry, differentiation and so on. Just pull out Z2, that's all. Pull out mod Z2. Mod Z2 here. Okay, mod Z2 square will come, then raised to half, so mod Z2, that will cancel out. So then take the limit, it is easy, it will be just this much. Okay, so that will define whenever one of the point is infinity. When both the points are infinity, what should I do? I am forced to define that equal to zero. There is no other choice. Okay, so take this as definition. Now you have to verify that for this extended thing also, the triangle inequality is true. Okay. So, Z infinity, you take some other point here. Okay, Z1, Z2, some other Z prime, and then you have to show that this inequality is not very difficult. So, that also I will leave it to you as an exercise. So, extended complex plane has a metric here. So because of this denominator here, we were able to do that. If you just take the new linear matrix Z1 minus Z2, you could not take this limit as Z tends to infinity. Now you see why the geometry or the analysis, whatever you want to say, is reflected here. So, okay. More about this one, I will tell you when the time comes. All right. The chord metric is very important in the geometric function theory of one variable complex numbers. Okay. So, the geometry involved here will be explained to you a little later. All right. So, let us take a break here. Today, we have done some good work. So, next time we will see more. Thank you.